Blessings to you from Holy Trinity Lutheran Church in Glenview. I'm Pastor Chris Nepton. Thank you for joining us for worship today, this 12th Sunday after Pentecost. We are so glad that you have found us on YouTube. You can find all of our services from the last weeks on YouTube. And you can also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Please do like, share, and subscribe. And when we mean share, we mean share the good news of Jesus Christ. This is one of the easiest ways these days to be an evangelist, to share that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, is worth following, is worth taking up as a way of life and to be in a relationship with. So if you find this meaningful, and we hope that you do, we ask that you would continue to join us each week and also invite others to watch with you. And so this morning we begin with our order of confession and forgiveness. We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of the Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your great compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. Amen.
Morning has broken. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rain.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Ever-loving God, your Son gives himself as living bread for the life of the world. Fill us with such a knowledge of his presence that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life to serve you continually through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading is from Proverbs chapter 9. Wisdom has built her house, She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her animals. She has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servant girls. She calls from the highest places in the town. You that are simple, turn in here. To those without sense, she says, come, eat of my bread, and drink of the wine I have mixed. Lay aside immaturity, and live and walk in the way of insight. The word of the Lord. Our second reading is from chapter 5 of Ephesians. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
The gospel reading for this 12th Sunday after Pentecost is the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We continue to make our way through this 7-week series through the letter to the Ephesians. This is the second to last week, the 6th week, if you will. Being reminded that as Paul writes, or someone writes in the spirit of Paul to this Ephesian community, that they would be made aware, that they would be reminded that we as Christians, we are one in Christ. This week we have a very short reading. It's only 5 verses, verses 15 through 20. That's 6 verses, 15 through 20. Very short. So I have to draw your attention to the verses around the text. I have to draw your attention to them because they help us make sense of the few verses that we have this week. Please pay attention to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, where the writer says this, be imitators of God. As beloved children and live in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Last week, you'll remember that I preached that to be one in Christ, to be an imitator of Christ, we are to live selflessly as Jesus did. Remember, Jesus is fully God and becomes fully human. Jesus is fully God and fully human. Not taking the privilege of being God for himself, Jesus comes down to give selflessly that we might know that God desires to be joined together with us once again, that our minds would acknowledge and know that God desires nothing more than for us to be one with God as we knew and understood and experienced in the beginning. To be a Christian, to be a follower of Christ, means that we are to live as Christ lived, to be an imitator of Jesus Christ, and to live selflessly, to put others ahead of ourselves, to put their needs ahead of our own. That's not something that's popular in our world today, is it? No, rather, the saying or the way the world would live, those in the world would have us know, trust in, and to live out our lives is, well, it's that verse. It's that saying according to the Bible, which isn't even in the Bible, that God helps those who help themselves. Nothing could be farther from the truth. God helps those who can't help themselves. And that means each and every one of us. See, without God, there is no life. We have no life. We can't help ourselves to life. We can't do anything to be saved or to work our way or to climb up to God. God comes to us. God selflessly gives of God's self through Jesus Christ, that we would know how we are to live as one in Christ. Our text reads today that we are not to live in selfish ways, but to give of ourselves selflessly, not greedily, and not to live for our own desires. The verses before our reading, and even as we see in the beginning verses of what we have today, they call us to live not greedily, not lustfully, not evilly, not in any of those ways, but rather to live selflessly. Paul writes, "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time because the days are evil. So don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is." And here's the warning, don't get drunk with wine, for that's debauchery. I think the spirit of that saying is this, is look, don't try and escape from the world. Don't try and pull yourself out of the world by getting drunk and having your mind clouded. But rather, know that Jesus comes. That to live in the way of Christ, to live as one in Christ, we know that we are in the world, but not of the world. That Christ is working to lift us above all the pain and the suffering and the strife, to lead us to the joy and the abundance and the goodness and the love that God has for us. Because our hope is in Christ, we seek ways to live out God's love and goodness, not just for ourselves. We have come to know and trust that love, that goodness, but we seek to live it out so that others would know it as well. We're grateful for what Christ has given us, and we are also grateful and aspire for the opportunity to share that love which Christ has given to us also. You see, as Christians, the writer is reminding us not to rely on sensual pleasures, on natural items, on things such as drink or food or sex or money or anything that escapes, even video games or social media. Don't get too deeply involved in those things. They're not evil, but they're not where our hope is. Our hope is in Christ. Our hope is in a God who comes to us that would remind us that we are beloved children of God. And though there is suffering in this world, we find hope and peace and life through Him. Take advantage of the opportunities that we have, dear brothers and sisters, dear siblings. Take advantage of the opportunity to be in Christ, to live in Christ. That's what the second half of our reading calls us to today. It says, but be filled with the Spirit. As you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, and giving thanks to God the Father at all times for everything in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Our focus in all things in life, in work, in rest, in study, in service, in our family lives, our focus is Christ. Knowing the love and sharing the love. I encourage you, please come worship. Worship on YouTube as you are right now. When you're ready, gather again here in this space. We're gathering each and every week at 9:30. We're wearing our masks. We're remaining physically separated, giving space. But in that space, we gather knowing that Christ is in our midst, knowing that others around us trust and know and believe and aspire also to share the love of Christ as we have known. We come to experience that love so that we might go out and share that love in the world. We do it week after week, Sunday after Sunday, month after month, year after year. We have done it for 2,000 years. And we have been imitators of Christ in this place for nearly 70 years. We have been given a gift to gather. And so I encourage you, come to worship each week. Gather, read Scripture, do this during your daily life, and come and join us each week for this as well. Share what you have given. Share what you have received. Give thanks. Give thanks to God for all which God has given, and give thanks to God for the opportunity to share with others. Because being in Christ, as I've said before, is living selflessly and generously for others. Quite often we're so afraid that if we do something for others, we'll lack something personally. This week I heard a talk by a woman, an African woman, a banking leader. Her name was Ibukun Awasika. And she reminded those who she was speaking to, and I heard this. She reminded us of this truth. Common good always turns out to be personal good. Whatever we do for the good of others, whatever we do for the good of all, it ultimately benefits us as well. Martin Luther King Jr. reminded us of this same principle, that working for the common good is also working for our own personal good. Jesus came for the common good of all creation, that we would know God's love, that all of creation would be redeemed, that we would be one in Christ because of Christ. I have seen evidence of that here as well. If you remember years ago, we gathered on a Sunday evening to discern what our congregational values are. And you'll remember it's youth and family, meaningful worship, services and outreach, and also relationships. We value those things. But in that conversation, one of you spoke up and shared the truth that you know, the surprise that comes. This was said, "I'm always surprised by how much I receive when I give of myself." Jesus gave all of himself to the point of death. And not that creation has ever escaped, but God. But doing that for the common good, God regained our minds, our hearts, the love that we have for God. And we are called into that same project. We're called into that project of creation and recreation, receiving that salvation, that that salvation might be made known to others. And so remember this, to be one in Christ is to be invited into the project of redeeming the common good, the good of all creation, that the world may be one in Christ. Amen.
One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we bless, and we, though many, throughout the earth, we are one body in this one Lord. Gentile or Jew, servant or free, woman or man, no more. One bread, one body, one Lord of all, one cup of blessing which we
in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Let us pray. God of wisdom, enlighten your church. Guide theologians, biblical scholars, authors, and seminary professors as they seek greater knowledge and invite others into deeper understanding. teach us to ask faithful questions and open our minds to new ideas. God, in your mercy. God of creation, mend the earth, cool warming oceans, and preserve melting ice caps. Increase our awareness of changing climate patterns and reveal new approaches to the ecological challenges we face. Shield those in the path of hurricanes or tropical storms, also those who are being affected by wildfires in the western half of our nation. God, in your mercy. God of all nations, direct our leaders. Grant them courage to lay aside political grudges and renew their determination to address difficult conflicts. Guide them in the work of reconciliation. God, in your mercy. God of compassion, tend to the wounded. Rescue those tormented by mental illness or mired in addiction. Ease the anxiety of those struggling with dementia. Come quickly to help all who are grieving and all those who suffer. Especially today, we pray for Henrietta Mueller, Sue Morency, Ellen Sturm, Bev Tarno, and those we carry in our hearts yet not mentioned here. God, in your mercy. God of beauty, inspire artists. Bless those whose visual and musical gifts enliven this assembly, especially Justin Brick and Carolyn Sanderson. Bless the creative work of poets, hymn writers, composers, painters, sculptors, and others that enrich our worship and daily life. God, in your mercy. God of resurrection, bring us to new life. Give us the light, living bread from heaven through which we abide in your love. And on the last day, raise with us all the saints to eternal life. God, in your mercy. We lift these in all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. As followers of Christ and those who believe and trust in the providence that our Creator has given to us each and every day, we give thanks that you have continued to allow God to work through your life and so abundantly provide for the ministry which is done here at Holy Trinity. We also thank those of you who give to other ministries as well, especially where we are partnering with the Greater Chicago Food Depository this month and next. We thank you that you continue to send in your offering through the mail by dropping them off at church using your bank's online bill pay function and also the Simply Giving program, which we have set up here at the church. Thanks also to those of you who give through our website, myhtlc.org/online-giving. As always, we want to remind you that it is because of your gifts that we are able to live and to share the life-giving bread of life, which is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that those in the world would have a real and present and physical reminder that God's love is for them. And so, giving thanks, we pray. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen. Thank you once again for joining us for this time of worship. We do pray that you have found it meaningful and that you would join us again next week. You can always find us on YouTube and follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Please do like, share, and subscribe. Invite someone to watch with you or simply forward this video on to them that they too can know just how much God's love is for them and for all of creation. Until we gather again next week, please be well, stay safe, and receive this blessing. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God.